Good morning, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to this webinar. We're looking forward to talking to you. I'm Ed Landquist. I'm a shareholder in the National Office of Baker Donaldson. My practice is limited to intellectual property, and I'm here with Memphis shareholder Scott Douglas, whose practice is also limited to intellectual property. And we're going to talk about recent developments this year in intellectual property. A couple of housekeeping notes. First of all, there's a Q&A box that you can submit your questions. Please feel free to submit those questions, as we really like to have the interaction. As it says on the slide, a PDF of the presentation is available in the resource list and will be emailed to attendees in the coming days. And then please provide us with your feedback at the end of the webinar. And if you have any other topics you'd like to hear from Baker Donaldson, please put those in as well. So we've got a lot to cover today. Obviously, with the importance of intellectual property to our economy, we're going to cover all five areas: trade secrets, patents, trademark and trade dress, copyrights, and licensing. Let's start with trade secrets, and there are a few trends in trade secrets. One is, we've been seeing a lot of large damage awards. There's been a clarification to a pleading standard in certain courts, and obviously we've got a lot of electric car cases, given that EVs and lithium-ion battery technology is so important to today's economy. Let's start with a very salacious case, and this is Appian versus Pegasystems. This is out of the state court in Virginia, and as you can see, there was a $2 billion jury verdict in state court. The facts of this case were particularly appealing because Pegasystems actually hired an Appian employee to be what they called in internal emails their own spy. Not only that, but in debriefing this Appian employee, the Pegasystems engineers would actually videotape the debriefing so that they could have a good record. So if you can imagine, the proof in the case was pretty significant. Additionally, the Pegasystems used some of their Indian business partners to set up fake accounts on Appian to get additional information that they couldn't get through this mole and through other means. And there was at least one email where they said, "As a result of this, we will never lose a sale to Appian again." So additionally, in Illinois, we have the Motorola case that had a $746 million initial award. So this is just to show that trade secrets can be very valuable. And so therefore, on the one hand, it's important to protect them. And on the other hand, it's important to make sure that your employees are not committing trade secret theft.
So we'll move on to the Oakwood case. Thank you for that, Ed. And the Oakwood case actually came out in 2021, and it's a Third Circuit case. So two factors counseling against a recent update in IP, but I think this case is instructive, will be instructive for our practice and for any trade secrets consideration. Considerations going forward in the next few years. So and the reason for that is the Third Circuit here set out, actually said in their opinion, that they wanted to use the opportunity to clarify the standard for trade secrets issues and specifically trade secrets pleadings. So the background here is the plaintiff, Oakwood Laboratories, was developing very specialized pharmaceutical therapeutic injection. I think it was microscopically injected pharmaceuticals. It was a highly intensive research process and background. They invested 20 years and something like $130 million in their efforts. And Dr. Thanu was the chief product officer there at Oakwood. And then Aurobindo approached Oakwood to try to enter into a joint development agreement. Aurobindo came and said, "We want to be in this field, but we don't have the scientific expertise. We'd love to work with you and do some kind of tie-up." So they had you know, put an NDA in place. They exchanged a memo setting forth the trade secrets that Oakwood would be sharing with Aurobindo. But as so many of these cases happens, the tie-up did not go forward. It fell apart, and they couldn't come to an agreement. And then after it fell apart, 6 months later, Dr. Thanu was hired by Aurobindo as their new product development officer. And then within different facts unfolded over the next 1 to 4 years, but basically between 1 and 4 years after that, Aurobindo released the same a competing product to Oakwood's product. And Aurobindo had only been working on it again for basically a few years, whereas Oakwood had spent 20 years. So there was clear, at least to Oakwood, there's a clear misappropriation of trade secrets here. But the district court didn't see it that way and ended up dismissing their complaint or authorizing them to amend their complaint 4 times. And after the filing and dismissal of the third amended complaint, Oakwood finally took the appeal up to the Third Circuit. And the Third Circuit, like I said, took the opportunity to say, this is, here's what you need to do to plead a trade secrets case. And so it's instructive to attorneys and people who are considering trade secrets issues to review this opinion, just to see kind of the explanation of what is good enough and what isn't good enough. And what we learn is essentially, you have to plead some aspect of your trade secrets, or at least, as they put it, the boundaries within which the trade secret lies. So the defendant at least knows what you're accusing them of misappropriating, and so they can understand if kind of what they have to defend. And then the allegations need to be plausible but not probable. And this obviously is our kind of known standard pleading standard, but the Third Circuit's point here was trade secrets are no different than any other claim, even though we have this very, it's a very specialized type of intellectual property that inherently must be kept secret. You still don't have to, there's not a heightened pleading standard. I think one of the key outcomes was that essentially the use or the misappropriation of a trade secret was a sufficient allegation of a bad act. You don't have to prove that they actually incorporated the trade secret into a product or used it in some other, you know, monetized it or anything like that. The misappropriation is the harm. And so it's, like I said, it's an instructive case. I would advise anyone to review it. And then these other two cases, just while we're on the pleading standard, kind of further elucidate the standard for trade secrets pleadings, both authorizing the use of circumstantial evidence to support a claim. So that goes back to the plausible but not probable pleading standard. But then the Mallett case clarified, again, I think instructively, that while there is a kind of a standard pleading standard for a trade secret complaint, when it comes time for seeking a preliminary injunction, there is going to be, you know, kind of the higher threshold of evidence that you have to plead.
Yeah, so Scott, I think this is just a continuation of federal court's emphasis on Twombly pleadings, right, which is obviously people are not able to engage in the sort of the very vague notice pleading back in the day. And also, I think this is a pretty good indication in the Oakwood case of a defense counsel doing a really good job of really hitting hard, filing motions to dismiss and filing motions for judgment on the pleadings to really require the plaintiff in the case to identify the trade secrets. Because, I mean, when you have a trade secret case, that's half the battle. If you're on the plaintiff side, you want to keep it as vague as possible so you have some field for maneuver to change your trade secrets or amend your trade secrets. And then if you're on the defense side, you want to require the plaintiff to identify the trade secrets as quickly as possible, just so then, as a defense counsel, you can pick away at them from time to time, as opposed to just trying to pick away at this amorphous blob of general statements.
Good point, Ed. You want to take the Blade Room case?
Okay. So a couple things. I think the takeaway from the Blade Room case is, and you see this a lot in confidentiality and non-disclosure agreements, where in addition to having the normal exceptions to trade secrets, where you have It becomes public through no fault of the recipient, where the recipient discloses it through independent means, or someone approaches recipient through independent means, right? Those exceptions, this particular agreement had a two-year limitation on the term of the agreement. The problem with that is whether or not the trade secret still existed or not, the recipient was able to disclose the information learned after that two-year period. So this is more of a drafting thing to make sure that you're not limiting the requirements of non-disclosure to a period of time, because we know that a trade secret and confidential information can go for much longer. Secondly, while we're talking about drafting tips, something else that we always like to put in our employment agreements and in particular is to require the employee not to use the trade secrets of their prior employers. You know, from a practical point of view, an employee that's going to use the trade secrets of their employer is going to do that anyway. But at least if you're standing in front of the court representing the new employer, then you can say, Your Honor, you know, we told them not to do this and they agreed not to do this. So, you know, it was out of our control. And then the SMASH case talks about, you know, what we need to do to protect information in the age of COVID. You know, we know that everybody's working from their house or from their kitchen table or, you know, if you're lucky, from an island someplace, right? So we just have to make sure that we have the discipline to protect trade secrets, whether we're on-site or off-site.
So the these we identify these electric car cases more as a point of interest. All of these are still ongoing. In fact, I think they're all in some phase of discovery or some pretrial status. So there's nothing notable, nothing legally notable to remark about them, except that they demonstrate a few things. One, there are a few tropes in trade secret cases. One, we've already acknowledged, which is where, like in Blade Room and in Oakwood, two parties, a common trade secret dispute arises when two parties meet to do some sort of acquisition or tie up or joint venture, and that fails. You often see trade secret cases sprouting out of that. And then the other instances where you have one, you have usually an established company that loses employees to a startup or a competitor. And that's the case with all of these cases here, I believe. One of these, the DeLorean case pertains to a founder who went to a competitor. But otherwise, it's employees who were being acquired along with the information they knew, possibly some documents that they possessed and that form the basis of the trade secret cases. So it goes back to Ed's point about employee agreements. And one thing that we also counsel people is when you're revising these employee agreements, making sure that they have the trade secret portions in them. Also make sure that they have your standard IP assignment language in them, if you don't already have that in place, so in the employee handbook or it's an easy thing to just throw in when you're hiring new employees and are binding them on the trade secret stuff as well. So something to remember.
So I like to talk about how people are misappropriating trade secrets. And my new favorite way is that, as we all know, you can actually put digital files and photographs. So one particular employee concealed stolen files in photos named after Pokemon characters. So obviously we see a lot of instances of people just lying to access trade secrets, as happened in the Pegasystems case. And then of course, something that we never see, and that's an employee downloading or emailing information to their own personal email account or to their personal drive or a thumb drive. In fact, we suggest that, if at all possible, to think about limiting access to flash drives or having some alarm that goes off with your IT system if somebody does load a flash drive or tries to download significant amounts of information, that somebody gets a warning on that. And then we're seeing more and more criminal charges being brought. Keep in mind that there are, criminal statutes at both the federal and state level. So here are all instances where in businesses where someone was charged with criminal trade secret theft.
One thing to note about the criminal aspect, that Motorola v. Hytera case, it was on an earlier slide, that one is notable as well because it involved not just a large damages award, I think over $500 million, but after that case was resolved on the civil level, earlier this year, the U.S. government brought criminal charges against some of the Hytera employees and former Motorola employees who had gone to Hytera for their trade secret theft activities. So trade secret takeaways. First, beware the most common potholes, the not-quite non-disclosure agreement, as we call it, where you didn't have the proper amount of specify the right amount of time that was supposed to keep you were supposed to keep the trade secret secret. Beware of employee walkouts. You can't keep an employee from leaving, but you can do everything legally to keep them from taking or using the trade secrets. And then make sure you have a plan in place to protect your trade secrets, and not only have a plan in place, but enforce the plan. So part of that is having the proper agreements. Part of that is ensuring that your employees sign those agreements. Part of it is ensuring technical and physical security, and knowing exactly what you consider to be trade secret and what you're protecting as such.
So this year has been an active year in patent law. Obviously, we had more cases interpreting patentability under Section 101 subject matter patentability. We're going to talk about inter-parties reviews and estoppel, the continuing fight for whether or not you can bring a case in either the Eastern District or Western District of Texas, and then we're going to talk about a scary case relating to enablement in the Amgen case. So let's start with Alice. You know, Alice was decided by the Supreme Court in 2014, and it limited the subject matter patentability under 35 U.S.C. Section 101. The takeaways from Alice are twofold. One is software applications and inventions are still patentable, right? The takeaway number two is you just have to make sure that you have to identify the problem that you're solving and then identify a solution to that problem. And as long as you do that, and as long as this problem you're solving, the way you're solving it is new, it's still possible to protect software cases. Now, we have a question in the Q&A, which is, what is a recommended practice for identifying to confidential/secret material? That's a good question. Obviously, one is we want to make sure that we're placing ledgers on documents and emails, you know, talking about how this may contain confidential information. Of course, it would be better if the approach was nuanced and not everything was labeled as confidential or secret. However, labeling everything as confidential or secret is better than labeling nothing. Then there's the issue of just making sure that only certain people have access to that confidential information. So I hope that helps. And if you have a follow-up, again, please put it in the chat. Back to Alice and Section 101. We had these two companion cases go to the Supreme Court at the same time, and we actually handled the Spirion Inc. versus Procon case. And in that particular case, our client Procon received a cease and desist letter from Spirion relating to a patent that dealt with automobile dealer management. So it was basically a system that allowed you to plug something into the car through the OBD2 port that would then allow you to determine where the car is, making sure that the battery was charged, because as a dealer, you don't want to take somebody on a test drive and then the car not start, right? And so there were other things that were covered in these claims. So our client Procon filed a declaratory judgment action asking the court to find not only no infringement, but also to find invalidity under Section 101, following up on the Alice case. Then Procon filed a counter-complaint alleging validity and infringement. Procon came in then and filed a motion for judgment on the pleading, saying that the court could rule on the could dismiss the case under a Section 12 standard as opposed to a motion for summary judgment standard, because everything that the court needed to decide was already in the complaint, between what was in the complaint and what was in the patent, which was attached to the complaint. And we had some really good language in the patent, which talked about how the problem that they were trying to solve was that programming is difficult. It wasn't talking about a new code. It was not talking about some kind of problem in traditional coding. It was just that coding took a long time. And then the other thing we had going for us is, and this is another trend, is that the patent said, well, you know, all this stuff, to the extent that we're not disclosing it, is just off-the-shelf technology. And that was being done to meet an enablement requirement, which is another requirement of patent law. But by doing so, the district court, in granting the motion for judgment on the pleading, said, look, you're saying that everything here is off the shelf. You're saying that the only problem that you're solving is that software programming is hard. You're not really stating a compelling problem. And your solution to this compelling problem is just using off-the-shelf technology. So the court grants the motion for judgment on the pleadings. It goes up to the Federal Circuit. The Federal Circuit affirms the district court finding without opinion. Okay, so it was a summary affirmance. And then Sperian's counsel files a petition for a writ of certiorari to the Supreme Court. And we respond to that. We're feeling pretty good about it, except this other case to the left, American Axle, was coming up, and American Axle was getting incredible play. Frankly, the American Axle case also had some fuzzy claiming, basically saying that generally that you were going to be able to balance axles and make sure that they were aligned by using some vague harmonic formulas. Actually, they were not formulas. They were more theories. And so in that case, the Federal Circuit, both as a single panel and then en banc, found the patent to be invalid under Section 101. So we're cruising along with the Sperian case, thinking that the court's just going to summarily dismiss the petition for writ of certiorari. But unfortunately, our case and American Axle went to conference on the same day. And so we were really concerned that we were going to get caught up in the American Axle wave. But luckily, both cases, the petitions were denied by the Supreme Court. And so, again, the takeaway from this is, yes, you have to be careful when you are claiming software patents, but they can be patentable.
So, over the last decade, there have been several significant changes in patent law, starting in 2012 with the American Invents Act, the AIA, and the Alice case came a few years after that. I think it's 2014, maybe. Looking back at the American Invents Act, that put into place the inter-parties review process at the Patent Trial and Appeal Board, PTAB, and the last decade has seen kind of the courts trying to figure out what exactly that law meant, especially in the realm of estoppel. So the law put into effect this inter-parties review process, but then said, as you see on here, the statutory language, a patent claim brought for inter-parties review may not request or maintain a proceeding for the office with respect to that claim on any ground that the petitioner raised or reasonably could have raised. And so the last decade has seen courts wrestling with what that exactly means. And first, the PTAB in a bit of bureaucratic self-preservation, basically, and the Federal Circuit too, basically said any arguments that were brought here to the PTAB but that were dropped were not subject to this estoppel rule. And we've seen over the last few years kind of trying to claw that back to the original statutory language until we get to this Broadcom case in 2022, where the Federal Circuit has made clear that estoppel applies not just to claims and grounds asserted in the petition brought to the PTAB, but any claim that could have been brought or asserted in the petition. And so the long and short of what this really means is for about a decade, the inter-parties review process was seen as one of the big arrows in the quiver for defendants to attack a plaintiff's patent lawsuit. So if a plaintiff, kind of had the option of choosing how to go after the defendant, and they could maintain the district court action, but the defendant could try to stymie things by challenging validity at the PTAB, the PTAB. Now it will give more pause and more consideration to a party before they decide whether they actually want to seek review at the PTAB or if they want to try their hand in district court. Because once you've raised your claims at the PTAB, you don't have another shot at raising them. So if you get them all through, that's one thing. But if not all of your claims get taken up for review by the board, then you've essentially lost those.
Yeah, go back to estoppel for a second, Scott. Let's talk about the problem with IPRs and estoppel, right? I mean, IPRs were intended under the America's Invents Act to make it an inexpensive way of invalidating a patent, right? Unfortunately, these IPRs have become very, very expensive. Well, not very, very expensive compared to patent litigation, but still pretty expensive. And right now, the best estimate for a fully developed IPR is somewhere between $300,000 and $500,000. So, we are dealing with a significant expense there. But here's the other problem. Right now, the PTAB, the Patent Trial and Appeal Board, is limiting what you can actually argue before them as with respect to validity. For example, when you file a request to institute an IPR, what you do is you basically file this brief and you file a lot of claim charts if you're arguing invalidity under either novelty under 35 U.S.C. Section 102 or obviousness 35 U.S.C. Section 103, where you set the claim chart up, which in the first column you'll have the claims, the claim language from the patent. And then the second column, you'll set forth what's disclosed in the prior art reference. In other words, the patents or other disclosures that came before the patent at issue. And then the third column, you will set forth why the patent or other reference affects the validity of the claims, right? And so you may file, 20 different claim charts with different permutations of prior art. However, when it gets down to the actual argument time and briefing time, the PTAB may only say, hey, you can only argue X, Y, and Z. We're not going to let you argue A, B, and C, right? However, because estoppel applies to anything that you brought or could have brought, right, then A, B, and C, which you brought but the PTAB did not allow you to assert, is now subject to estoppel. Now, looping estoppel and IPRs in with Section 101, there are efforts in Congress to change both. In fact, there are several past commissioners of patents that are directors of the Patent Office who are trying to change the statute on 35 U.S.C. Section 101 to more accurately portray what they believe to be the original intent of the statute, and to clarify what is and what is not patentable subject matter, right? So that is moving forward. There's a question in the chat about whether it's going to happen over the next year or whether any changes to the IPR procedures will happen over the next year. And I wish I could predict that, because I think that there would probably be some tech stocks whose value would either go up or down based upon that. So we do know that the efforts are moving forward. However, we don't know when those are actually going to pass. But one of the things that we are advising clients, especially on software applications, is that If you were to file a software application today, you will not get examination for likely 18 months to 36 months, right? So by that time, the law will likely have changed. Therefore, you need to be making decisions on software cases based upon what you think that the law will be or what the law can be 18 months to 36 months from now. Because if you don't, you're not going to file now. And then when the law changes later, right, your clients are not going to be in a position to take advantage of that. And they're going to be, you know, giving up potential patent protection. Sorry to interrupt, Scott.
No worries. Okay, so staying in the patent realm and the litigation realm, let's look at these, what we'll call the Apple cases. The In Re Apple Inc., which is the Federal Circuit opinion from November, is, I believe, the seventh Apple case alone that the Federal Circuit has issued either a mandamus to the Western District of Texas, or granted overturned a decision by the Western District of Texas, specifically pertaining to a motion to transfer. So I mentioned that there, 2012, we had a big change in the law with AIA, and we also had the Alice case that had talked about. We also had a venue case called TC Heartland a few years ago, I think maybe about 5 years ago. And prior to the resolution of that case, the Eastern District of Texas was a really popular place for patent litigation. After that TC Heartland case came out, Eastern District kind of lost its luster. But then in, I think, 2018, a judge was appointed in the Western District of Texas that had a very friendly view towards plaintiff patent cases in the Western District of Texas. And so because of a lot of tech companies that were either based there or had other major operations there, the Western District of Texas kind of became a popular spot. And companies like Apple were desperate to get out there and back to the Northern District of California or Delaware or wherever else. And the judge in that district continues to stymie efforts. And so Apple brought all of these motions to transfer in all of these cases and has prevailed on at least seven of them at the Federal Circuit. And the point is the Federal Circuit made clear to the Western District that it needs to give immediate consideration to motions to transfer instead of kind of slow rolling or letting the facts play out. And what happened here was Apple filed its motion to transfer at the beginning of the case. The court basically decided not to decide it and instead sent scheduled discovery to occur and said, well, I'll decide the motion to transfer at the end of discovery. Apple said, you know, that's not fair and it's, the case will be over and we'll have essentially, once we do get transferred, there'll have been two parallel litigations that happen. And so I point out this opinion because it's the clearest example that I've seen in a while of a court that was obviously an appellate court that was obviously irritated with the district court, mandating that Apple, that the court resolve the motion to transfer immediately and not wait. And so it'll be interesting to see if that, this latest opinion has an effect on the Western District, or if it continues to kind of take its more plaintiff-friendly interpretation of the transfer rules.
So next we've got the Amgen case, which is kind of a scary case because basically traditionally, if you're writing claims for a patent application, you really just have to enable one example of the claims. And frankly, claims are intended to be broader than that and cover several examples. So the Amgen case, we hope, is only going to be limited to the life science and maybe limited to the facts of the case. In this particular case, the patentee gave one example of a several types of molecules that could be used to meet the specific claimed invention. But then the claims covered, well, it could also be all these other molecules, and defined these other molecules not by type, but generally by grouping, so sort of a genus as opposed to a species. And as a result, the Federal Circuit said that the invention was not enabled. It is actually going to be decided by the Supreme Court soon, and we'll get some clarification. Again, we hope that enablement is limited to the facts of this case, because otherwise we're going to have a situation where we're going to have a lot of ground to cover, and another significant defense is going to be added, which is enablement, because, you know, potentially you would have to enable every specific invention that could be covered by the claims, and that would add a lot to patent infringement cases. So we see that the Federal Circuit continues to wrestle with AIA, such as with IPRs and other things. And, you know, we're seeing the Supreme Court take more and more cases in the patent realm, at least one every term, but they're not going to make significant changes. They're probably going to nibble away, which now leads us to trademarks and trade dress, Scott.
All right, so we're going to look at a couple of different aspects in trademarks and trade dress. We'll look at a recent case in the Sixth Circuit on cars, a case from the Ninth Circuit on trade dress and games, some clarification in the law in trademarks and search engines, and then some international issues as well. So starting off with trade dress, this case came out of the Sixth Circuit. As I said, it's Mahindra and Mahindra v. FCA U.S. There's a complicated procedural background that I'm not going to go into, but I think the nugget of the case is the safe distance rule, which the Sixth Circuit made clear in this opinion is alive and well, at least in our circuit. Safe distance rule basically says where a trademark or trade dress infringer redesigns their product or their brand or what have you, they have to redesign further away from the senior user, from the senior mark or the senior trade dress, than a normal non-infringer would have to redesign or would have to stay away, because they already have a history of infringement. And so in order to eliminate any likelihood of confusion, and in some cases, in order to ensure that a bad actor stays far away from the senior user, you have to redesign to what's called a safe distance. This case involved an Indian car manufacturer that had a car design that looked like a Jeep, and they were prohibited by the ITC from importing this due to the infringement mostly of common law rights. And then they tried to redesign it, so they had the 2018 and 2019 versions that were barred. They tried to redesign, I think, with the 2020 version. And the FCA U.S. tried to prevent the importation of this redesigned version through the ITC, and they cited the safe distance rule, and the ITC said that was essentially that rule was not part of the ITC's toolbox, and that they would not enforce what they, I think, termed as inequitable relief. And so then FCA, actually Mahindra, brought the declaratory judgment action in the Eastern District of Michigan, and FCA lost on the safe distance rule there as well until they appealed to the Sixth Circuit. And the Sixth Circuit took the opportunity to explain there's a long history of the safe distance rule, and it's still important. It's still at least a consideration to be had by the district court in this case. And it also emphasized that willful infringement, which might have been shown by the infringers here, only increases the distance required to avoid infringement under this rule. The safe distance rule is alive and well here.
So in the case of PNP Imports, at least in the Ninth Circuit, this clarifies that for the purposes of establishing secondary meaning, which you have to demonstrate in trade dress, that there just has to be an identification of the singularity of the source as opposed to the identity of a source. In other words, when you have a descriptive trademark or trade dress, right, you have to be able to identify that consumers associate that descriptive mark or that trade dress with a source, even though that source is not known. So again, this clarifies that the specific source does not have to be identifiable, just that there has to be a single source. And then trademarks and advertising, this 1-800 contacts case is very important with respect to keywords. We know that keywords are used for, you might buy Google AdWords or something else, so that when people use a specific keyword, then you get preferential treatment in the placement of the results from that search result. This clarifies that a competitor can buy keywords or AdWords using the name of their competitors, right? But other cases continue to make clear that when you're doing that, you cannot dynamically insert those competitors' keywords into the ad results. And we've seen a lot of companies get into trouble with this because the default is that it will actually insert the keyword into the search results. So basically, let's say that Coca-Cola buys Pepsi as a keyword. If they don't switch off dynamic word insertion, when the search results come up, Pepsi will be embedded into the ad results, right? And then the contact information, the website or whatever, will be a Coca-Cola site. That's what we call dynamic word insertion, and that's a big problem.
Yeah, I don't think that opinion, tell me if you disagree, I don't think that opinion changes the fact that the potential for liability for dynamic word insertion.
I agree with you, Scott, because there have been a lot of cases which have sort of hinted that the purchase of a keyword could be a problem, for example, initial interest confusion or something like that. But courts have yet to take that approach, which is good. But again, you still cannot dynamically insert the words into the ad results.
And I want to go back to the PMP case real quick. Another little practice tip. We often get questions on, whether something is worth filing a trademark application for, whether trade dress is worth enforcing, or that sort of thing. But I think this case is an object lesson that it is worth enforcing and protecting, whether it's trademark or trade dress. And the reason being that this involved a long game version of Connect Four. But you'll notice the parties here, neither party is Hasbro, which is the major toy and game manufacturer that makes the home version, the tabletop version of Connect Four. Basically, they copied the Connect Four game and made it into a lawn version and sold it, and then got into their own trade dress spat over the look and feel of the lawn game version of Connect Four. So Hasbro might have had a stake in this if they had, either innovated to the long game or had taken more affirmative steps to enforce their own trade dress. Something to consider there. So there are a few interesting things going on with trademarks abroad. One is the Abitron v. Hetronic case, which is for the Supreme Court right now, and it involves the international enforcement of the Lanham Act, and I think damages for foreign sales for use of a mark abroad, basically testing how far the Lanham Act goes beyond the borders of the United States. I have a guess as to how that will come out based on recent Supreme Court jurisprudence. The Metaxi case, I think, suggests that maybe the court will determine that the Lanham Act doesn't extend overseas, but we shall see on that one. A more definite case is the Lodestar v. Bacardi case, and it gives guidance on the question of priority with Madrid Protocol trademark applications. So this is kind of a specific and not altogether common form of trademark application. It doesn't apply to U.S. Domestic only users, but for foreign companies coming here or foreign companies going abroad, the question was in this instance, it was a foreign company who had filed a Madrid trademark application and gotten a registration in the United States, and they had not started using or proved that they had started using the mark. And this company tried to enforce against, I think it was Bacardi was trying to enforce against Lodestar, and had not started using the mark here. So the question was, even though you have a trademark registration under Madrid, can you enforce without use in the United States? And the answer is, you as the Madrid registration holder do have priority, but you can't enforce your rights until you begin using it. And then once you do begin using the mark in the United States, you can enforce even against a party who started using before you, as long as you had the priority on the registration.
So looping back to a question in the chat, the question is, what would be the cause of action if we discovered a competitor is/has inserted keywords from a trademark in their ads? And Scott and I have handled several of these. The cause of action is trademark infringement and unfair competition. Basically, the dynamic word inserter is committing trademark infringement, and because they're using a protectable mark and they're creating a likelihood of confusion as to source, origin, sponsorship, or affiliation. And we've actually been successful in asserting those claims, especially against competitors. And it's all part of an overall brand enforcement program. So, and again, if you tie that in with, you know, if you obtain a judgment or a settlement agreement against a competitor, then going back to the Mahindra case that Scott covered, where they have to stay farther away, so they can no longer rely upon a safe distance rule. That safe distance has to be farther. It can be, again, it can be all part of a very successful and very valuable trademark enforcement program. So in 2020, we had the Trademark Modernization Act, and one of the things that it did was it clarified that trademark infringement for the purposes of a permanent injunction does create irreparable harm. As you know, we had the eBay case that said that in for patent infringement, irreparable harm could not be presumed. However, the Trademark Modernization Act clarified that for trademark infringement, it is presumed. The other thing that the Trademark Modernization Act covered is that it is easier to expunge a registration, right, to prove that the registration is no longer in use. Another aspect of the Trademark Modernization Act is there's language that intimates that if someone files a renewal or an 8 and 15 for a registration where not all of the goods and services were in use at the time, then the entire registration can be invalidated. Go ahead, Scott. Sorry.
Sure. I'll jump in. The first sale doctrine applies in the trademark realm, as it does in several other aspects of intellectual property. And essentially, once a party has sold its product, it can't enforce, it can't claim trademark infringement if that product is then resold as a standard in the standard resale situation. But that doesn't necessarily apply if the mark is tampered with or the quality of the goods is altered or engineered in some way. And we saw this in 2021 with the Nike v. Mischief case, where Mischief's production studios, I think is what they're called, is a kind of rebel shoe design company, and they like to take existing brands of shoes and add their own twist to them. So in this case, they added a very interesting twist by making the 1990, I think it was 97 Air Max Nike shoe, which is kind of an iconic, well-recognized shoe, at least in the shoe world, and added all sorts of satanic references to it as part of a marketing campaign with a rapper named Lil Nas X. And it caused quite a controversy. They only sold, it was a limited run. I think they had 666 pairs of shoes that they sold. But this was, I would say, a clinic by Nike in trademark enforcement and, you know, litigation tactics. Within 2 weeks of Mischief Studio launching this product, Nike had filed a complaint and acquired a preliminary injunction, or at least a TRO, and achieved settlement with Mischief. Something to consider, you know, this goes back, I think, to the importance of having, knowing what your brands are and what your marks are, and having a plan in place to protect them and enforce them before the infringement ever happens, so that then it makes it a lot easier to enforce. Just on the repair and upsell topic, which is what Mischief claimed they were trying to do, is they were making their own product and they weren't infringing Nike, but I think they were wrong on that case. They've had other cases where Mischief, I think, has been more successful making that argument. We've advised clients in the past, one client in particular that had a major consumer products company come after them, and the focus has to be clarifying that you're not clarifying to your client, and clarifying in the way that you're using a mark that it's not actually a use of the mark, it's not an infringing use, and it often means either not obscuring but not emphasizing that you're recycling someone else's products. But I'll in the interest of time, I won't go too far into that subject.
So this next case is pretty interesting, and we need a little bit of background. So in Rogers versus Grimaldi, we had a case where Grimaldi was the director of a film, and he wanted to have the title of his film Fred and Ginger, after Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. It was not about them whatsoever, but it was just about a couple. Ginger Rogers' estate filed suit to prevent that from being used under the theory of trademark infringement. The Supreme Court said, well, you have an interplay with the First Amendment here, and because it is a work of art, namely that the film is a work of art, we're going to say, well, the First Amendment applies here, so there's not a trademark cause of action for using Fred and Ginger in the name of the film. So flash forward to today, we have a situation where VIP Products creates a chew toy in the shape of an old number 7 Jack Black bottle. It's as opposed to Jack Daniels, it's called Bad Spaniels. There are also some plays on old number 7, you know, if there's a play on something number 2. So the district court found that there was a likelihood of confusion, which, you know, I can agree with. But then the Ninth Circuit reversed, saying that Rogers versus Grimaldi must be applied, and we've got to think about the First Amendment here. And because the First Amendment applies, then Jack Daniels cannot stop the manufacture and sale of this chew toy. And there was a lot of concern in the trademark bar that basically, with the Rogers versus Grimaldi case, once you get to the determination that the product is a work of art, then it's game over. So in the Ninth Circuit case, the Ninth Circuit said, well, this chew toy is a work of art, so game over, right? So Jack Daniels requested cert, and it is actually, it's not been argued yet. The briefing's still occurring. And the Supreme Court reached out to Disney to ask them to file an amicus brief talking about things like, well, if there is a Mickey Mouse chew toy or something like that. So we'll see how that goes going forward. And so, Scott, let's talk about the takeaways.
So, as it says here, I think there have been some generally positive developments for brand owners in the last year, just with the way that some of these we'll be watching what comes of the Bad Spaniel Supreme Court case and the Foreign Enforcement Supreme Court case regarding these trademark issues.
So copyright developments, we're going to talk about several things, including the Oracle case on fair use, and then the transformative debate that's going on in Goldsmith versus Warhol. And then we're going to talk a little bit about Section 1201 and getting past the code of consumer hardware devices. So let's start with Oracle versus Google 1 year later. If you all recall, Oracle had purchased software from another company. Google wanted to develop an IP that spoke with that software. And to do that, they needed to use certain code to interact with the Oracle software. The Supreme Court said, well, there are millions of code or millions of lines of code to the Oracle software. Google was only using a few thousand, and it was necessary for the API to communicate with the software. So as a result, the court said this is fair use because Google's use of the identical lines of code was transformative. And this is likely going to frame the court's decision in Warhol versus Goldsmith.
Yeah, and I think so far the outcome or the takeaways from the Google case have been that determination on transformativeness has been somewhat limited to software issues. And so the Supreme Court has taken up another copyright case this year on the meaning of transformativeness in the Goldsmith v. Warhol case. And this was a situation where Lynn Goldsmith took the photo on the left on the screen there of Prince back in 1981. And then after Prince hit big, I think in 84, Warhol came across that photo and used it and made 16 different alternative prints, which he allegedly kept in his private collection until 2016 when the Andy Warhol Foundation licensed some of those photos for use in a retrospective on Prince's life. And so the question is whether this Warhol's adaptations transformed the original copyright, because Lynn Goldsmith said that she was a copyright owner and she was entitled to compensation for their use and monetization of these photos. The Goldsmith lost at the district court level and appealed and won at the Ninth Circuit. Because the Ninth Circuit said that the district court judge had made too subjective of a determination. And so this is up before the Supreme Court this year, and it will be interesting to see where they draw the boundaries of transformativeness. And I think it'll be helpful. Hopefully they'll come to a clear result in a more broad-ranging result than the Google case led to. But check in next year, and we'll see how it came out.
Yeah, so it was interesting on the Prince case where, ever since COVID hit, Mr. Justice Thomas has developed a voice and is asking more and more questions. For the longest time, I think he'd asked one question over time. But one of his questions in this case for the Warhol estate was, let's say that I am a Syracuse fan, and I just want to take the Prince poster and paint it orange. Is that transformative? So again, we'll see what happens. And then we're going to end on Section 1201 enforcement. We know that the Digital Millennium Copyright Act set a anti-circumvention proceeding. So basically, it made it a cause of action to circumvent anything that would prevent, well, that would turn off the anti-circumvention technology. In other words, like there are certain devices that have software into them and they have this anti-circumvention technology. There are limitations to that because we want to make sure that our washers and dryers and other home appliances and automobiles can be fixed by people. And so as a result, the Copyright Office has the right to include certain classes of products that you have that the producer has to make available software and other means to fix the product. So I want to thank you on behalf of myself and Scott for joining us today. And if you have any questions, please put them in your evaluation. And if I don't see you all before the holidays, happy holidays and happy new year. Thank you very much.
Thank you.